All right, shalom. Okay, so this will be what part? I guess part four, right? Well, let's go through this. Now we'll get to one of the main matters that we have to address. So we touched on this one right here, the lost sheep, right? That was the second one, the lost sheep, right? Jah is seeking the lost sheep, and as his co-shepherds, right? As his co-shepherds. Or if he's a hunter, as his co-hunters, because he says he sends shepherds, you know what I'm saying? He sends hunters, sends fishers, or his co-fishermen. As his co-laborers, we also must be about seeking the lost sheep, all right? Then we touched on, we actually had touched on Jah consuming fire. We went to Hebrews for a moment. We also gave the warning, right, the warning and instructions from Hebrews. So let's just put this down as Hebrews, right? The third part, Hebrews, right? Warning, right? Warnings and instruction. Now check out the word sound power of that word. You know what I'm saying? Instruction, structure. There's a structure, there's an order. You know what I'm saying? If it's not in his order, then you know it is out of order. All right, and we'll put on the fire, the consuming fire right there, and acceptable in word, right? Because these are some of the key, you know, the key words right here. You know, so even at a basic elementary school level, you know, Sam, we have kindergarten. I think we spent a long time, many of us in kindergarten. You know what I'm saying? And whether we graduate or we're kicked out, we're out of kindergarten now. Now we have to begin in the basic elementary school. So this would be like the Rastafari basic yeshiva level, where we sit, you know what I'm saying, and listen and reason, you know what I'm saying, and build and Bible study and iron sharpen iron. But the discipline in the future church is to address some of the challenges, tribulations, persecution, mixed up moods and attitudes, all kind of folly, underground kind of activity that I think most of us who slip or who stumble, whatever, is because of ignorance. Though there might be others who normally do what they do, but that's what Christ already says concerning them. It says, woe to the world because of offenses. They may have come into Rastafari, but all their ideas concerning his majesty are worldly. They're not according to his teaching. For it must needs that offenses come, right? It's necessary that offenses come. It says right here, but woe to that man by whom the offense cometh. Now, why is this word, right? Why is this word so important right here? Well, let's go to disorders at the master's table, which are rebuked in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Hold that page on Matthew chapter 18, and let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. This is what it means by rightly dividing the word of truth. Because in that place, it says right there that it must needs, it's necessary that offenses come. And offenses is qualified according to the Amharic, the higher level, the overstanding, as being stumbling. Something that causes stumbling or tripping. So that trips up ones. Like, I don't know how such and such could have done that to I or the I or, you know, you like, and that makes you now wonder, like, man, I trusted that one. I trust this one. I can't do that because such and such and such, you know. So these offenses come, right? But now, here's what the word says. It says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 17, it says, now in this that I declare to you, I praise you not, that ye come together not for the better, but for the worse. And we kind of have seen like a red flag in a sense to say, oh, whoa, someone's are coming together right here, even in Rastafari name in particular, also in fellowship with I and I, but it's not for the better. And there's a lot of bitterness and everything. So this is why we're preaching this message on this subject matter, especially. So verse 18 says, for first of all, so let's deal with first, putting things in its rightful order. When ye come together in the church, you understand, or church of Kali, right? Church of Kali, right? Not just the Kali, but church of Kali. I hear that there be divisions among you, and I partly believe it. I partly can accept it as trustworthy and true. Remember what Christ said? They had asked him, who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? right? Who is the greatest? They want to know who is the greatest. So one's seeking self, you understand? Instead of his self, the true Ras is Ras Tefari. Ras means head, and Ras means self. So as his reason, even when the manly when the manly heal up, was reasoning, and we talked about that, and he reasoned with me about the fact that, you know, seeing more into the name of Rastafari as the head to be feared, you understand, or self-respect, you understand, those two, but yet one and the same, you is all embedded, you understand, when we know the Amharic keys and the Amharic code and Rastafari, he is the head, you understand, the goose and the guest is the head, you see all the heads around, you understand, but see, he's the center head, he is the head to be reverent. He is I and I self-respect. You understand? So we have any self-respect, you understand? We'll listen to his warnings and his instructions, and we'll build our house on that solid foundation, on that rock. So here, Paul is saying, well, he's hearing about division, that this one is not getting along with this one, and this thing happened, and such and such. And most of the stuff is like petty stuff. It's like little stuff. It's little stuff. It's not real stuff. You understand? It's little stuff, you understand, that ones have not recognized themselves in the light. See, when we look at the scripture, it's like a mirror, Paul says. So, but when people look in the mirror, they go away from the mirror forgetting what sort of person they are. But we have to remember what we've seen in that mirror and say, like, if you look in the mirror, you see something, there's something right here, you look in the mirror and say, oh, I got to take this off. You know what I mean? And you clear that out. That's why we look into the word, we look into the scripture. Some don't look in the scripture because they might know what they will find. So that's why he said he's partly, to a degree, he can accept that as true. Verse 19, for there must be also heresies. Wow. There must be heresies. Or it says here, there's a subscription, says schisms. Schisms. Like we say, well, why are there so many different ones? And like Rastafari, there's this mansion, that mansion, this one, that one, and this kind of Rastafari, and that kind of Rastafari, so on and so on. Why is all of this? Well, the word explains the glory of his majesty, the Kubra Nagusa Nagas tells us, for there must be also heresies among you, schisms, right? That they which are approved may be made manifest among you. That those who are truly approved, well, how are they approved? Because they say that they are approved? No. It's because of the compatibility and embeddability of Jah's word. In other words, they have emptied out themselves and filled themselves up with the word of the King of Kings and his Christ. So therefore, they are reflections, right, of being workmen, you know what I'm saying, that need to be praised, that need to be recognized, because as the word says in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15, study. Study. That's what we begin off first, is study. You know what I'm saying? Even in the early days of Rastafari, ones would come groundation and bring forth certain books and articles and maybe Aishans and some Yukayud, some food or whatever. And they'd be studying. That's real church. That is real churchical. You know what I'm saying? Study to shew thyself approved to God, to Jah. You know what I'm saying? To his imperial majesty, to his standard. You know what I'm saying? We say that, well, there's Jah Rastafari. Well, his teaching is the teaching. Everything else is schism and ism, right? A workman that needeth not be ashamed. A workman that you can't even ashamed a real workman because they know where they stand. They stand on solid ground and not on sinking sand. They're standing on the rock. You're standing on the Rastafari order of the Church of Christos. All right? So it says, rightly dividing the word of truth. Rightly being able to explain the word of truth. All right? Verse 16, it says, but shun profane and vain babblings. People want Babylon about Babylon. Babylon, 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 Babylon. You know what I'm saying? And they don't recognize he already gave us the victory. But we have to work it out. You know what I'm saying? In spirit and in truth. For they will increase to more ungodliness. It's like when you start to listen to some babbling on about Babylon and a lot of other stuff, even on the internet, and people write funny, strange comments, and you know, after a while, you want to, like, say some really bad word, but remember, may the word of I and I, what? Mouth, and the meditation, the iditation of I and I, heart, be humbly acceptable in thy sight. Oja Rastafari. So we don't want to, you know, go out that way. You understand? Because that's going astray, right? Astray. And there's much more in this chapter. We'll hopefully get into this in another reason. But here we go. How do we resolve, right? How do we resolve disputes among the brethren and sisters in the Rastafari? How do we deal with it? Do we go to court? If we know where one is Rastafari, I nine Rastafari, do we take them to the Babylonian grudge? Do we go for a Babylonian grudge and say, yes, this is a Rastafari thing, your honor. Please settle this dispute between I and that man there that used to be I and I brother. Is that what we do? Do we go to court to settle these things? Many ones have, and that's a violation. That's why that breach is still there. Because ones haven't repented of that. They still justify it as though it's the right thing. And it's not the right thing to go to court. You know what I'm saying? To go to court against the brethren. You know what I'm saying? You mean there's no other way within Rastafari liberty? I can see taking a Babylonian to court. So you're saying that the brethren there, because they disagree with you, they're Babylonian. Although they have also gone through blood, sweat, and tears and stripes for Rastafari, but because they don't agree with you on this issue, you're going to take them to court, and it's not like them shot you or them juke you or like them, you know, rob you or whatever, but you're going to take them to court about something. You think it's right? You know, and that's a folly. That's a folly right there. We tried to warn ones back in 1990-something, you know, but they didn't want to listen. You know what I'm saying? Now people wonder, well, how come such and such is the way that it is? You know what I'm saying? Well, the word explains it very, very clear to us. And if we had a little more time in this reason, we'll get into Galatians. You know what I'm saying? Galatians, because it actually tells us that, you know, we're going to court, and we're going to court before the Gentiles. And then we're going to let the Gentiles know, yes, this is what Rastafari do for us. We got our own land, our own organization. But then they notice that we can't even agree. Like, there's nothing in our way, truth, and life that can help us resolve these disputes equitably. But we have to go to court. You know what I'm saying? We have to go to court before the Gentiles and ask the mercy of the court to handle our Rastafari business. And then even after the judge or the grudge make the decision, mine and mine are going back and forth to court. You know what I'm saying? Yes, we brought up certain charges about some improprieties that were going on. And we even said in our our decision and our explanation and statements that we thought it was because ones didn't know, because we're still learning things. You know what I'm saying? And we point out as a mistake or an error among brethren, but people caught feelings. You know what I'm saying? I mean, admittedly, we didn't really think that would happen, but so it did happen. Anyway, it's in the book of Galatians that goes into that. You know what I'm saying? Saying that, and we go to court, you know, before the Gentiles. You understand? Before Gentiles. I mean, to just think about all the indignities, you understand, and for the Gentiles to handle I and I Rastafari, right, I and I Rastafari business, you understand, or the business that the King of Kings have left to I and I as the Rastafari, all right? So, anyway, we'll get into that. Let's first of all hear what Christ says, you understand, on this point, and then we'll get into the apostle on that. We'll probably make that a kind of a court series. You understand? Court TV, Rastafari Court TV, right? But anyway, disciplining the future church. The future church is now, right? The future church, then, Christ said that he will build his church. There will be a church age, you understand, as it was a church age. And we can see the end of that church age is right here, even in that double blow, that double hit with Apollos, via Abuna, and with Melis and Nawi. 4 days apart, you know what I'm saying, as it was reported. You know what I'm saying? But here we're speaking about the discipline in the Beta Rastafari. What is the discipline in the Beta Rastafari? Right? Verse 15, chapter 18 of Matthew, Yemateos Wengel. And the Milo, and it read the Englishenya and the English King James Version says, moreover, if thy brother shall trespass against thee, go and tell him his fault between thee, the I, and him alone, right? If he shall hear thee, if he shall shema thee, or sema, mesmat, thou hast gained thy brother. That's the qualification the Holy Spirit says to remind ones. Remember what Christ gives the qualification of who is your brother or sister. Because see, a lot of folks just see a black man or a black woman, and they say, oh, that's my brother, that's my black brother, that's such and such. Well, you know, in the world and on the worldly level, you can understand that. Right here, Christ answered and he said to them in chapter 12 at verse 48, he says, who is my mother and who are my brethren? Remember, they were standing outside. He was lecturing and teaching, and they were outside. They wanted to speak to him, but he was in a sipkat, a sermon, a reasoning, teaching, and he sent this message, or he communicated this message when he got word, right? And he stretched forth his hand toward his disciples, right? Towards, like, you all, right? And said, behold, my mother and my brethren. Those who are spending time and listening to these sermons and lectures and teaching and taking notes and studying and praying on it, you are I and I mother and I and I brethren, right? You understand? And then he goes on and he says the key is in 1250, right? That's a 1250. You understand? Roger that, right? In 1250 he says, for whosoever shall do the will of my Father. He didn't say that whosoever shall do my will as Jesus or Yeshua. He said, whosoever shall do the will of my Father. You understand? Of my Father, which is in heaven, the same is my brother and sister and mother. You know, we're going to do a whole series on how Yeshua HaMoshiach was the first real liberator. Yeshua HaMoshiach is the real liberator, you understand, of the woman, of the so-called weaker sex or weaker gender or the one that was deceived, you understand, or Eve was raped, but he is the liberator of the woman, you understand, in particular of the black woman. You understand, because he didn't say brother and mother, you understand, as the question came, but he said brother and sister and mother. Right, so the brother and the sister, the sons and the daughters, so we are children. We are those little ones. You see, because if you're not in the Metaf Kiddush, and on that level, you're still a little one. If you haven't mastered the Nababet, the Hahu, the Fidel, you are still a little one. You understand? If you don't understand some of the basic foundations of our Ritua Haimanot, of the Tawahido faith, you are still a little one. And there's no insult about that. Yeah, anybody who want an insult, that you could tell they're out of the way. They're astray. They need to watch it. You understand? Caution, caution, warning. So I wanted to put that there, that the qualification from 1250 is doing the will. From Matthew 1250 is doing the will. But before you can do the will, you have to what? Take that yoke, take that discipleship, that discipline, and learn of Yeshua HaMoshiach. And learn of Geta Jesus Christus, of Getachin. Verse 16. So he said first that if your brother trespass, he didn't say sin, trespass, offense, all these are different key words and we need to study them. But he says trespass. The trespass is like you draw the line and he crosses that line, right? He offends you. You understand? Right? It says go and do what? And tell him his fault. Rather, it doesn't say offend. It says he's trespassed against thee. You should not take it as an offense. That's what the Holy Spirit said. We shouldn't take it as an offense. But he didn't say offense. He said they trespass. And they go beyond, above or beyond, right? And tell him his what? His fault. His fault. Where he is faulty. Between the I and him alone. Or between the sister and the sister alone. Right? And if he or she shall hear thee, thou hast gained thy brother or thy sister or thy mother in Rastafari, in the Beta Rastafari. Verse 16, but if he will not hear thee, you know, people say, well, that's great, but suppose they don't listen. Well, if he will not hear thee or she will not hear thee, it says, then take with thee one or two more. Now, I want you to understand that it's not just take anybody from the world or your friends or people from your past life or people that always agree with you or people you hook up so you know they're going to give you a favorable decision. No, it's about one or two from the Beta Rastafari. I mean, ones who are real that you can verify. You know, and not just ones that, hey, brother, what are you doing? Come here for a moment. I want you to, you don't know where they're coming. You don't know if they're standing on sand or the rock. You're saying you're looking on a rock foundation or a sandy foundation. So they'll 1 minute say, yeah, I agree with you. And then you look at them away and then they'll change the decision. You don't want wishy-washy. You understand? But take with thee one or two more from the brotherhood, from your fellow disciples. You understand? Or among your fellow study partners, the ones who are growing and learning and have taken that shema, can be a witness to that shema. That in the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word may be established. Because then you have witnesses. They say just take with you one more. It says two, right? It says two, right? One or two more. One or two more. So it's you and it's one or two more, right? One or two more. Then in verse 17 it says, and if he or she shall neglect, be negligent and careless, neglect to hear them. Right, they don't listen to whatever. Tell it to the church. So that's why there's a need for the Beta Rastafari. There's a need for the churchical in every region where there's two or three, you understand, and they're in agreement about His Majesty's teaching. Don't mean that we have to just gather here or there. Yo, we have the technology. We're in the IRIC. We can gather on the phone. We can have call conference, so forth and so on. But it has to be grounded. You have to begin first from where you're at. And begin first with yourself. So it says that one will neglect to hear them and tell it to the church. But if he neglect to hear the church, right, let him be to thee, or she be to thee, as a heathen man or a sheathen woman and a publican and as an expletive deleted politician. You understand? Let them be like somebody who, you know, like somebody out there in the Babylonian. Let them be like somebody out in Babylon who defends Babylon. Why? Because they obviously has neglected. It's not just you telling them. That's what happens a lot. My brother-in did something to me. I didn't like it. So I didn't even tell him. I went and told some other ones. So now the word starts to circulate like gossip, like a cancer and everything. Now it's tearing down the whole fabric of the community. And then we wonder why we can't do business. Why we're not making money? How come Deuteronomy 8 and 18 don't apply to we? You know what I'm saying? Then he give us the power to get wealth, but it's not about his covenant. If it's not in his Al Kidan and his word agreement, then we're doing our own thing. And we're deceiving ourselves to think, well, I burn herb. I got dreadlocks. I wear red, gold, green. I say Selassie. You know, you're saying Selassie. You don't even know what you're saying. Some folks get offended. Just like they got offended when we say we shouldn't say Farai. We should say at least Teferi or Tefari. Then they had to go to Ethiopia, and somebody must have schooled them, you know what I'm saying? But at least they got to learn it eventually. But it's a shame they couldn't receive it from I and I. But if you have to go, I don't know how many thousands of miles to learn that, you understand? And somebody's been telling you that, you know, it's like you're not recognizing Jah's spirit, you understand? But anyway, it says, verse 18, verily, amen, I say to you, the I, them all. It says, amen. Whatsoever ye shall, here it goes again, right? Bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatsoever ye shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Now, if there's nothing deeper than that, if you really start to understand this spiritual level of warfare, you understand, this spiritual warfare, what we don't take care of, you understand, in our own circumference or in our own relationship vis-a-vis Rastafari and what we allow to go on also creates a residual effect, you understand, in the heavens or in the spiritual world and in our community, right? Verse 19 says, again, I say to you that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything, as touching concerning anything, that they shall ask. Now this is what really challenges whether the word is real, right, and we're being unreal, or the word is unreal, and we're so-called, quote, unquote, real, right? Because it says, again, I say to you, so you said this before, but again, I say to you that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything, concerning anything, right, that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. Now, this is we're not accessing our blessing. Because perhaps if you're not in the obedience, then it makes no sense to even think about accessing it, because it's always shut down because of a lack of amen, a lack of true and faithful witness. You understand? Because if you don't have no faith in the word, or the faith in the King of Kings, what he has said, or the reality of where we're at and who we are, then you really can't agree. But it's saying that if two of you, if just two, you, the power of two, this is why we say discipleship, the havrutas or the havrins, you understand, the so-called buddy system. But you cannot have a buddy system to come together until each of them, you understand, reconcile, you understand, in Yeshua HaMashiach to the Father. Because you can't come to the Father. You can't come to Kedemawi Haile Selassie apart from Yeshua. He said it. We're saying it. You understand? The angels say it. Every true brother and sister knows it's true. You understand? And now none of us have so-called been perfect. You understand? But now we're on that road to perfection and know it. Now, it says again that if two of you agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask. That's amazingly, we're not tapping into that. Either we're believing people, men and people on TV, on the internet, stupid Babylonians and stuff. We're not accepting that. You understand? We're not accepting that, the reality of that. That in the kingdom, the Mengishta Samayat, which the true Rastafari, the Beta Rastafari is, that anything we ask is according to his will and his order is done, son and daughter, is done. You know, if it's in accordance with his will, because you can't ask for, oh, hurt that man over there, that brother over there, because he said something, something made me feel. No, it's not his order, and that might actually come back on you. You understand, really, so you can learn a lesson. You understand? We're going to sum this up right here with verse 20. And verse 20 in the Schofield Reference Bible, there's a subscription that says the simplest form of a local church. I want y'all who see it and have a scripture to make note of that. The simplest form of a local church. So when we talk about church and establishing ministry and working for the brothers and sisters in fellowship, this is what we're talking about. You know, and this is exactly what John says, right? The simplest form, right? And let me use this as a diagram right here. The simplest form. Right, it says right here, verse 20, it says, for where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. Now, I want you to pay attention to this right here, right? The simplest form, where there are what, two or three that are gathered together, right, in my name, there I am in the midst of them, right? So this will be one, this will be two, and this will be three. Yes, it's a pyramid. Yes, it's a triangle. Uh-huh. But understand, he says, what, two or three? Remember, the two is the Havruta. Christ sent them out two by two. You understand? Two by two. And this is what we've been speaking about and been wanting to teach on this, but the Spirit told me to hold up. And then I get to recognize why the Spirit told me to hold up. Because before you can deal with two by two, you have to deal with one-on-one. You understand? In other words, it's the I and I. What do we mean by I and I? It's I, you understand, the personal person, and it's Iesus or Iesus. It is the Father. In other words, it's the Son and I, the King and I. One has to first come to the King in Yeshua HaMashiach, in his word, in spirit, and truth. Recognize his teaching. Recognize his testimony, repentance, have a change of mind, pray for that change of mind, pray for that wisdom, don't doubt, You understand? Think about all the Babylonians you've been believing, and they've been letting you down, and you still, they'll come to you with another game, and you believe them. But Jah will come to you with his word, and you say, well, I doubt that, because look at those Christians over there. I mean, excuse me. We're not dealing on that foundation. We're dealing on the rock. You understand? The Rastafari order of the Church of Cristo. So it says right here that where two or three are gathered together, here's the key. Here's the key, my brothers and sisters, in my name, right? In Yeshua HaMashiach's blessed name. You understand? Two or three are gathered together in his name. Now, a lot of folks say, well, yeah, you know, we had a gathering. And the gathering was all right, but, you know, some stuff happened at the gathering. You know what I'm saying? But the gathering, right? The gathering. We were gathering. What were you gathering? You know, I and I just, you know, gathering. You mean you're not gathering in Yeshua HaMashiach's blessed name? You're not gathering in the number one Son? You understand? Don't you recognize that the way to the Father is through the Son? There's no other way to the Father or the Father's house except through the Son? Mm-hmm. Well, who's gathering in Selassie's name? Wrong. It is. Wrong. See, because you have to recognize that Christ said, if you keep my word, right, he says, I and the Father will dwell with you. You understand? But Yeshua is that link to the Father's house. Just read and study the teaching of his majesty. And if you think it's a lie, then go on as a lie. You understand? But if you accept that as true, you understand, then begin to meditate. Begin to pray on that. Think about that. Pray for wisdom. Pray for guidance. You understand? Pray to Abba in the name of Yeshua. You understand? That's what pleases Kedamawi Haile Selassie. That's what pleases him. You understand? We be trying to please so many men and people and always let down. Mm-hmm. But we don't want to please. You know, we have more faith in the men and the people when they let us down. And he said, oh, okay, just do this. And we do that, and he still let us down again. And, you know, but we don't want to please the Father. Something is really seriously wrong. But and remember, it's in our will. You understand? It's in our will. If we make our wills obedient to good influences, it's to show the greatest and avoid evil. And avoid evil, remember, to avoid evil is very important. What is evil? Evil is whatever Jah say is evil. Evil is whatever the King of Kings and whatever his Christ testifies to being evil. That's what's evil. Whether we like it or not, you got to recognize, see, it's grace and truth. Grace and truth. You understand? So you don't deserve no grace. You understand? Because grace is him giving us, even though we in our flesh are former state of what we used to be doing before we sighted Rastafari, even though what we did, we don't deserve it. We don't deserve his goodness. But that's his grace that he gives us. But to maintain that grace, you must maintain the truth. You understand? Just like if one is truthful with one, you understand? One can show some grace to them or even mercy. You understand? Because mercy is what protects us. See, mercy means that we already are judged. We recognize like someone coming for a judge, and they already gave the sin, or they already gave the judgment, and now the judge is doing the sentencing. And so you want to find out if that convict or whatever. We're all convicted. You understand? We're all convicted before his majesty. Let's reckon. We could be Rastafari, but we have to recognize that this is a grace. This is his grace. You understand? It kind of disturbs me when one's at, like, they found his majesty. His majesty wasn't lost. You were lost. Mm-hmm. You were one of the lost sheep he found, who he told to be as a child again, to remember to be a Hebrew, cross over from the low degrees to the high degrees, like making the sign of the cross from heaven, right, to earth, from low degrees to high degrees, right? The warnings and the instruction, the 1, 2, 3, you understand? And this is also when we say a church has to have, or even a local ministry, you understand, have to have at least 3 to stand as sponsor for the King of Kings. Mm-hmm. What do we mean? Because you're sponsoring, you understand, you are representing the King of Kings in this wicked and evil world with a whole bunch of spiritual warfare. So you have to be fully armed. Because otherwise, you know, we already know, a lot of us already know how we've been getting beat up in the world and everything until we find that, wow, all we had to do was come to agreement with a fellow brother or sister who's truly in agreement with the Father. So the first agreement, the I, is the Father and Son. In other words, it's us, our relationship must be in and through Yeshua HaMoshiach. You understand? It must be in and through Getai Jesus Christos. You understand? So you should be over the whitewash thing. So there's no really excuse. You understand? Now, we said we're going to stop right here or fulfill it right here, but the Holy Spirit gave us one more verse. One more verse that go along with Matthew 18 and 20. Right? And that verse is to be found in, I think, Ecclesiastes. Right? Ecclesiastes. Because in Ecclesiastes, it tells us something very, very interesting. Some might already know where we are going with this. You understand? But in Ecclesiastes chapter 4, turn your Bibles to Ecclesiastes, which means the preacher. Or really, it means the ecclesiastic, the one who is like the leaker, one who is learned. That's the one who was the preacher, one who knew, would tell and instruct because they had the knowledge of it, so others who didn't know could be instructed. You understand the warnings and the instructions. Mm-hmm. So you there, Ecclesiastes, or at least write it down. You understand? At least write it down or later on rewind this and take a note of it. All right, so Ecclesiastes chapter 4. Now the theme, they say, is unfolded. One, in view of the oppressions and iniquities of life. And I get an inspiration, the Holy Spirit, to just go through this right here. So as y'all wills, we'll go through this. So let's begin with verse 1 of chapter 4 of Ecclesiastes, or the preacher. So I returned and considered all the oppressions, or as Rastafari, as I and I say, the downpression, because they're not up-pressing us, they are down-pressing us. So I returned and considered all the downpressions that are done under the sun. Wow. Now you notice that word, I returned. It's in those Old Testament, in Yeshua taking that veil, you understand, as the bride takes that veil off, you understand, and he kissed the lips of those who answer appropriately. In other words, his words become your words, and then your answers are right and exact, and they are righteous when his words are your words. Not in self-righteousness, because that means you haven't received him, truly, if you still got that self-righteousness, right? So I returned, or to even say, like, I, in a sense, repented in an Old Testament sense, but in a New Testament sense, it's the repentance. And then you consider all the downpressions that are done under the sun. That's why most Rastafari, even at that infantry stage, is conscious of the trials and tribulations of what people are going through. You understand? That's why the music speaks to those sort of things and the downpressions and other things, because they consider all the downpressions that are done under the sun. And behold, the tears of such as were downpressed, and they had no comforter. Remember, this is Old Testament sense. So this is how we were before we were born again. We had no comforter. We had no strengthener. So people had to turn to drugs, or they had to turn to certain other kind of behaviors, or certain kind of vampiric people, you understand, sucking your energy. And on the side of their down presses was no power, was no Haile Selassie, no Kedamawi power, right? But they had no comforter. You understand? On the side of the oppressor was power. The downpressors had some power. Remember, this world, you understand, is a fallen world. You understand? In other words, this world, the God of this world, is not our Father. Our Father is not the God of this world. You understand? Yes, earth, rightful ruler, but not the God of this world. Those are two different. So we see right here that the comforter theme is present, right? The comforter theme. Right, they had no tutor. They had no one to strengthen them. No one to, you understand what I'm saying? They were overcome by all of this downpression. Wherefore, this is Shlomo or Solomon, right? Saying, wherefore I praise the dead, right? Which were already dead more than the living, which are yet alive. Therefore, people look at the past. You know, like we look at some of the artifacts from Egypt and the ancient times and Ethiopia and say, wow, back in those times, man, yeah, man. They really, we praise it. Not worshiping the dead, but we praise that they lived in better times than we do. seeing all that we see, right? Yea, better is he than both they, which hath not yet been, who hath not seen the evil work that is done under the sun. The evil work that is done under the sun. Again, verse 4, I consider all travail and every right work, that for this a man is envied of his neighbor. For this, so even when one does the right thing, because some people say, well, I'm trying to do the right thing and people just hating on me. But overstand, ain't nothing new under the sun, right? For this, a man is envied of his neighbor, of his bread companion, right? His balinjera. This is also vanity and vexation of spirit. So you always, that's what it is. It is what it is. But we have Yeshua. We have Yeshua Shalom. We have the peace of God in Christ. If we receive it, the fool foldeth his hands together and eateth his own flesh. You understand? So we see black on black crime, or we want to, oh, we should be like the Jews, or how come we always doing that to, oh, always black man doing to black man. The fool foldeth his hands. You understand? He's not about the work of the King of Kings, but he folds his hands together. You understand? And eateth his own flesh. Better is a handful. Better is a little herb. A handful with quietness, than both hands full with travail and vexation of spirit. And then, so some people say, well, we need money, but if you really are in the King of Kings, even that little bit that you have, you understand, with quietness, follow all the yank, 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 the can, all this concrete, it's better than have a whole bunch, yeah, you've done all that. I always say this, I said, wow, can you imagine? The one that will do so many wickedness to get money and hurt so many people and do all of these things just because they want to have that full hand of money and everything, and then the whole system crashes right then. Can you imagine that one? You understand? The last one to get rich, you understand? And then spiritually is dead for even trying apart from John, right? Verse 7, it says, then I returned and saw vanity under the sun. Then he returned, so either Solomon was able to see a prophetic vision of days like these, you understand? Or it's part of that repentance idea that when you wake up from the foolishness, you'd be like, yo, a lot of people just be wasting when you recognize what's really precious. You understand? What's really precious? What's really worth shit? Verse 8, there is one alone, and there is not a second. Sometimes some brothers say, yeah, man, in the area I am, I'm like the only, some of these other guys just be going, doing this and that, such and such. So there's one who's alone, and there's not a second. Yea, he hath neither child nor brother. You know what I'm saying? He don't have anyone that he's discipling, a lich, and he don't have a brethren. You understand? A havruta, in other words, right? It says, yet is there no end of all his labor. There's no end for all that he has to deal with. He's all by himself. Neither is his eye satisfied with riches. And so you see riches, but he's not satisfied with that. Neither says his eye satisfied with riches. Neither saith he, for whom do I labor? It's like people with 9 to 5 and all this. For whom do you labor? You understand? And bereave my soul of good. You understand? Where it's like people even, you see some folks that are making money, but they got no life. I mean, and it's wild. They keep doing it, and they be telling you there's nothing good. There's not. They just, you know, they just try to drown themselves. They drown themselves in their work. It says, this is also vanity. Yea, it is a sore travail. You understand? It's painful. If you got folks in your family, loved ones, you know what I'm talking about. But here's the point we was focusing on in spirit. Verse 9, Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 9. Two are better than one, right? So it says two, right, are better than one. You know what I'm saying? So when you come to that level, Jah will provide. You know what I'm saying? But two are better than one, right? Two are better than one because they have a good reward for their labor. You know, and they have a good reward for their labor working together. That work is sweet. And when the labor, you know, the reward come in, you know what I'm saying? You look at your brethren or your sister and you're like, yeah. It's like, you know, it's sweet. It is. There's a reward for it. And it says in verse 10, for if they fall, you know what I'm saying? If an offense, you know, woe to offenses, if an offense, a stumbling block, whatever, if they fall, the one will lift up his fellow. the one will lift up his brethren. You know, and the one will lift up her sisterin even. But woe to him or her that is alone when he falleth. You understand? When he falleth. For he hath not another to help him up. Remember, this is still Belui Kidan. This is still old covenant. Remember in the beginning, verse 1, it said, no comforter, no comforter. We have a comforter. That's why Yeshua said, I will not leave you comfortless, without a comforter, without an Atnai. I won't leave you like that. You know what I'm saying? I won't like leave you out there. I won't leave you hanging, in other words. Right? But apart from Christ, before we are born again, we don't have that comforter. You know what I'm saying? For he hath not another to help him up, to lift him up, to strengthen him. When everybody's saying negative stuff, he don't have the Spirit of God in Christ to say strengthen yourself in Jah. You understand? For this too will pass. Verse 11 says, again, if two lie together, right, if two lay down together, then they have heat. You understand? Like a man and a woman, right? Then they have heat in that sense. Or even like two best brethren or two best sisters, and no funny business. They have heat if it's cold. You understand? My pops used to tell me that, you know, back in Harlem, back in the days, like four of them or more of them, it seemed like was in the bed together. You understand? No hanky-panky, no funny business, but they got heat together. You know, they said niggas, we generate heat. You understand? So you understand. So if two lie together, then they have heat. But how can one be warm alone? You understand? How can one be? I think we all experience that sometimes. We were somewhere it's cold, we're by ourselves. You know, and even somebody that we don't really like a lot, even if they were just there, turn your back to me, man. Yeah. All right, cool, cool, man. You got some heat. You know what I mean? But when you're alone, you can't have that warmth. And when you're apart from Yeshua, you understand, in the spirit and the truth of his majesty, you're like that one alone. You understand? You don't got no heat, right? You don't have that consuming fire. And if one prevail against him, two shall withstand him. So if one overcomes you, there's still two. You see this two or three working out right here? This Trinity, right? This Trinity right here. And it says, and if one prevail against him, two shall withstand him, and a threefold cord, right? A threefold cord is not quickly broken. A threefold cord is not quickly broken. Now, I never thought I would have opportunity to use this. I got this. I really forgot who. I think it's Brother Beattie, Linville Samuels, that might have done this. I'm not too sure. But you see this right here? This is interesting. A threefold cord. You see that right there? A threefold cord. You see the Trinity? A threefold cord is not quickly broken. It can be broken, but not easily. Because if one prevail against here, you got two to withstand it. You understand? And you can see that same triunity right there. But it begins with one. One, two, three. Dun, 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 dun. You know what I'm saying? Right? But one, two, three. You know what I'm saying? You got that one, two, three. You got that Ivine Trinity, right? You have that Trinity right there. All right? So we want to show this. It's a little dusty here, right? Because we had it up like on the mantelpiece for a while. But anyway, yeah. So you see that right there, the threefold. The threefold right there, the Trinity. But it begins with one. You understand? So when your lights, you understand, when your lights come on, you understand, and you look for those who have their lights on as well. You don't have to make believe. You don't have to pretend. It's irritical. You recognize it because you took that beam out your own eye. So you can't even help the next one with a little speck in the demahai. Right? So let's conclude this right here. The last four verses, it says, better is a poor and a wise child. So we begin with the child, and we cipher full cipher with the child, right? It says better is a poor and a wise child, right, than an old and foolish king, who will no more be admonished, right? Babylon is like this. The Pope is like this old and foolish. Is an old and foolish thing, right? But they can't be admonished. I mean, what you gonna show them out of? You can't help them. Verse 14, for out of prison he cometh to reign. Whereas, so it says, out of prison, the poor and the foolish child, that's like I and I. I mean, the poor and wise child is like I and I, right? It's like I and I, and the old and the foolish king is like the king of this world. You understand? Which is Satan, the king of this world system. You understand? It's like that old dragon. You understand? That foolish one. The Satan know the word, but he don't do the word. You understand? So it says, for out of prison, he, speaking of the poor and wise child, cometh to reign. That's I and I, brothers and sisters. You understand? That's I and I. We come to reign, but we have to grow up to him in all things. Whereas he that is born in his kingdom, and it was he was born into his kingdom, becometh poor. You understand? He was born into his kingdom, becometh poor. It's like those rich kids, you understand, who have a rich parent who worked hard and did everything, and then they leave the inheritance to that foolish child born into that kingdom, and he becomes poor. You understand? He squanders his wealth, almost like the prodigal son, right? Verse 15 says, I considered all the living which walk under the sun with the second child that shall stand up in his stead. With the second child. You see, that second child is interesting because we was already born once in flesh, physically. You understand? But we ought to be born again in spirit and in truth. So we're like that second child. And it says, there is no end of all the people. There's no end of all the people, right? Even of all that have been before them. They also that come after shall not rejoice in him. Surely this also is vanity and vexation of spirit. Now remember, my brothers and sisters, that Ecclesiastes is an interesting book, but it's not New Testament. It's not the Adis Kidan teaching, but from it we can understand and see it in Christ. You understand? The main part right there that I think is really like looking ahead, because remember what Solomon said, he returned and he saw vanity under the sun. It's like he was able to see, you understand, what was going on in his time and even in time to come. The Kibbutz Negest says how he saw how the sun left from Israel, you understand, and set on Ethiopia, which is I, divine heritage. So this part right here, excuse me, was dealing with discipline in the Beit HaRastafari, discipline in the church. And once again, it's chapter 18 of Matteus Wengel, or of the Gospel of Matthew, that we have been studying in these four parts. So if you're only getting this part, check out the three previous portions of this. The law of forgiveness, hopefully we'll get an opportunity to touch on the law of forgiveness. For those who are studying with us, you have the opportunity to get a first read, you understand, and pray, you understand, before you even read, pray to Abba in the name of Gittai Jesus Christus, to Abba Kiddus, that he gives you wisdom, you understand, so you can overstand this word and receptibility to this word. So my brothers and sisters, may the grace and the peace of the King of Kings and his Christ be with you and be within you. Hul Gizeh, always. Shalom Ras Tefari.